فاشرف بي لاشتغالي بالعلم ولا تبغي به ما عشت يا ذا بدلا ويا له من شرف عظيم.
The author rahimahullah, he mentions three things that we have to come with. And we mentioned the first one, which is what was what? We have to obey Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger. And that is, أَنَّ اللَّهَ خَلَقَنَا وَرَزَقَنَا وَلَمْ يَتُرْكْنَا هَمَنَا. Allah created us, Allah provides for us, and Allah has not left us, not commanding us, nor prohibiting from us. بَلْ أَرْسَلَ إِلَيْنَا رَسُولًا. Rather, Allah sent messengers on us. And that messenger that Allah sent on us is who? Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَمَنْ أَطَاعَهُ دَخَلَ الْجَنَّةِ وَمَنْ عَصَاهُ دَخَلَ النَّارِ. Anyone who obeys the messenger is going to enter Jannah. And anyone who disobeys him is going to enter the hellfire. Then the Shaykh brought قوله تعالى, the statement of Allah, إِنَّا أَرْسَلْنَا إِلَيْكُمْ رَسُولًا شَاهِدًا عَلَيْكُمْ كَمَا أَرْسَلْنَا إِلَى فِرْعَوْنَ رَسُولًا فَعَصَى فِرْعَوْنُ الرَّسُولَ فَأَخَذْنَاهُ أَخْذًا وَبِيلًا. إِنَّا أَرْسَلْنَا, we have sent إِلَيْكُمْ to you رَسُولًا, a messenger, شَاهِدًا, testifying and witnessing against you, عَلَيْكُمْ كَمَا like أَرْسَلْنَا, we sent down, إِلَى فِرْعَوْنَ, as like we sent down on Fir'aun, رَسُولًا, we sent a messenger on him, فَعَصَى فِرْعَوْنُ, Fir'aun disobeyed الرَّسُولَ, he disobeyed the messenger, فَأَخَذْنَاهُ, we grabbed him, أَخْذًا, a grabbing, وَبِيلًا, which was severe. That type of tafsir that I did is called tafsir al-harfi. That's the correct way to do tafsir. Word for word, you know what it means. Then you can give tafsir al-ijmali, which is to do the overall meaning of what the verse means. Whereas when a word for word translation is being given to you, that is going to stick with you, because later when you see fa'akhadnahu elsewhere, you're going to know what it means. But if I give you overall meaning, you're not going to know each word. You're going to always need the explanation of an ayah of the Qur'an. So you have to learn the Qur'an word for word, which each word means. That makes you self-sufficient. You're never going to need to go every verse that you see. You say, I saw this before. And that's what it meant. So it means this in this place. فَأَخَذْنَاهُ, we grabbed him, أَخْذًا وَبِيلًا, a severe grabbing. Meaning we destroyed him, Fir'aun. Why was Fir'aun destroyed for? Because he disobeyed the messenger that was sent to him. The reason the author is bringing this for us is because, and that which he's trying to mention for us here is warning us in disobeying the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam that is sent for us. If we disobey him, then what will come to us is a severe punishment in this dunya and in the akhirah. And if we obey the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we're going to find success in this world and the success of the hereafter by entering Jannah. The second mas'ala that the author mentions here is ibtalu shirki fil ibadah, nullifying the concept of shirk in ibadah and giving Allah tabarak wa ta'ala his due rights. The Shaykh says, that Allah is not pleased, and yushraka ma'ahu, Allah is not pleased to be associated partners with him. So now the question arises, if Allah is not pleased with people associating partners with him, so why is it happening? So are you guys trying to say something Allah doesn't want is happening? Allah here is saying, أَنَّ اللَّهَ, verily Allah, لَا يَرْضَى, is not pleased, أَن يُشْرَكَ مَعَهُ فِي عِبَادَتِي, Allah is not pleased for anybody to associate partners with him. Allah is not pleased with him, صح? Hey, so Abdullah, why, if Allah is not pleased, shouldn't happen, right? Why is it happening? Yeah? Good. The rida is two types. This one is talking about is Allah legislatively, in terms of a legislation, Allah is not pleased with it. Shar'an, Allah is not pleased with it. But Allah is pleased with it, qadaran. Universally, Allah is pleased with it, that's why it's taking place. Like in shar'an, in terms of legislation, Allah is not pleased with it, because it's a haram. Are you with me? Are you with me, brothers? The shar'i means the halal and the haram angle. Allah is not pleased with killing. Allah is not pleased with shirk. Allah is not pleased with sins. He's not pleased with it in terms of the legislation wise. But universally, in terms of worldly, for it to happen, to occur, Allah is pleased with it, because He's the one who sanctioned it, subhanahu wa ta'ala. (Clears throat) The author says, أَنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَرْضَىٰ أَن يُشْرَكَ مَعَهُ أَحَدٌ فِي عِبَادَتِهِ. No one to associate partners. Don't associate partners with Allah in anyone. لا نبي مرسل. Whether that is a messenger that's sent, وَلَا مَلَكٌ مُقَرَّبٌ. And even if it's an angel that is close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't associate partners with him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the author, rahimahullah, he brought the ayah, وَأَنَّ الْمَسَاجِدَ لِلَّهِ. Verily the masajid are for Allah. فَلَا تَدْعُ مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا. Don't associate partners with Allah in ibadah. فَلَا تَدْعُ مَعَ اللَّهِ أَحَدًا. أَحَدًا is a nakiratun fi siyaqi nafi tufid al-umum, right? فِي سِيَاقِ النَّهِي تُفِيدُ الْعُمُومِ فِي سِيَاقِ النَّهِي. Because you're being prohibited here from worshipping other than Allah. And even if an indefinite occurs in the context of a prohibition, it shows generalization. So it means أَحَدًا, whoever it may be, even if it's a prophet Allah loves, whether it's an angel which is close to Allah, it doesn't matter. Never. The third that the author rahimahullah brings about is to free yourself from shirk and the people of shirk. And this one, the third one, is what necessitates from the first two. It's already min lazimi. It's a bimanzilati tabi'i al lazimi. It necessitates. If you claim to follow the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and Allah, and you also are fighting and nullifying shirk in ibadah, and you're against that and you're nullifying that, then by default the third one should also be, it should be in place by default. It should already be there. The hating of shirk is not just specific to shirk alone. It's also connected to what? The ones who are carrying shirk, the mushrik. You with me, brothers? It's the mushrik as well. Then the author brings قوله تعالى, the statement of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لا تجد قوما, you will not find a people يؤمنون بالله, who believe in Allah, واليوم الآخر, and believing in the day of judgment, يوادون, they show what? Allegiance to who? من حاد الله, those who oppose Allah ورسوله and his messenger, ولو كانوا آباءهم, even if it's their fathers, أو أبناءهم, if it's their children, أو إخوانهم, or if it's their brothers, أو عشيرتهم, if it's their family members, أولئك, the aforementioned people, أولئك, the aforementioned people, كتب في قلوبهم الإيمان, Allah has written and placed in their heart إيمان, وأيدهم, and Allah has supported and aided them, بروح منه, a ruh from him, this can be Jibreel, this can also be the Quran itself, وَيُدْخِلُهُمْ, Allah will enter them into جَنَّاتٍ, gardens, تَجْرِي, that runs مِنْ تَحْتِهَا, beneath it, الْأَنْهَارَ, rivers, خَالِدِينَ فِيهَا, they will stay in there forever, رَضِيَ اللَّهُ, Allah is pleased with them, وَرَضُوا عَنْهُ, and they are pleased with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, أُولَٰئِكَ, those who have been mentioned previously, حِزْبُ اللَّهِ, they are the allies of Allah, أَلَا, oh verily people, إن حزب الله, Allah's group, are هم المفلحون, they are the successful ones. May Allah make us from those who are from His حزب. حزب الله are those who have those characteristics. As for the ones we see right now, they are called حزب اللات والعزة. They are not حزب الله. They are حزب اللات والعزة. نعم.
اعلم أرشدك الله لطاعته أن الحنيفية ملة إبراهيم أن تعبد الله وحده مخلصا له الدين وبذلك أمر الله جميع الناس وخلقهم لها كما قال تعالى وما خلقت الجن والإنس إلا ليعبدون ومعنى يعبدون يوحدون وأعظم ما أمر الله به التوحيد وهو إفراد الله بالعبادة وأعظم ما نهى عنه الشرك وهو دعوة غيره معه والدليل قوله تعالى واعبدوا الله ولا تشركوا به شيئا.
The author رحمه الله, he mentions أن الحريفية ملة إبراهيم. That حريفية is the religion of Ibrahim. حنيفية in the شريعة it falls under two meanings. The first one is a comprehensive and a general meaning, and it is Islam. Islam is Hanifiyyah. And there's also a specific meaning, which is At-Tawheed. It means facing Allah, al-iqbalu ala Allah bit-tawheed, facing Allah with Tawheed. And if you face Allah with Tawheed, what necessitates from it? Al-maylu amma siwahu, that you free yourself, anything other than it, whether it be shirk or the mushrikeen. Then the author defined what it means, Hanifiyyah. He says, أَن تَعْبُدَ اللَّهَ, it is that you worship Allah, وَحْدَهُ alone, مُخْلِصًا لَهُ الدِّينِ, sincerity in the religion for him. And we said sincerity is two things that have to be found. If you want to be sincere, two things have to be found from you. إِخْلَاصُنَا لِلَّهِ صَفِّ الْقَلْبَ مِنْ إِرَادَةٍ سِوَاهُ فَاحْذَرْ يَا فَطِنْ. إِخْلَاصُنَا means what? It means two things. You cleanse your heart from everything besides Allah. That's the first thing. And the second thing is, then you do all of it for Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's a clean heart with intentions driven by it. It's like a car. If you want to clean the oil, you get rid of all of the previous oil, you clean the car, then you pour new oil. But if the old oil is in there, putting a new oil will not really change much, would it? So that's what the heart has to be. You have to clean the heart from everything. Everything that is connected to. And then you place in your heart, ikhlas, sincerity. All of it for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the author, he mentions, and before we move on to that, why does the author mention أَنَّ الْحَنِيفِيَّةَ, he could have just stopped there. Why does he have to say مِلَّةَ إِبْرَاهِيمَ, the religion of Ibrahim? Why did he not say the religion of Musa? Why not the religion of Isa? Why then not the religion of any other prophet? Why Ibrahim? We mentioned that in our sharh of Qawa'id al-Arba. It's two reasons. The first reason is two reasons why it's attached to Ibrahim. Number one is because the people in which the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam was sent to, which was Kufar of Quraysh, they already recognized Ibrahim and they testified to his nobility. They admitted that he's a noble individual, Ibrahim. And they even used to claim that they are from his lineage. وَيَدَّعُونَ أَنَّهُمْ مِنْ ذُرِّيَّتِي, they'll say that we're from him. We are from Ibrahim. That's what they would say. Not only that, they'll rather even claim أَنَّهُمْ عَلَى دِينِي, that they are upon his religion. They used to claim that. So this is Ibrahim. So that's why it was mentioned. Are you with me? Just like when you discuss a matter with a Christian, what do you say? When you discuss a matter with a Christian, what do you say? You say to him, oh, this is the religion of Isa ibn Maryam. The Christian will feel like, what? This is, yes, Isa. It brings him closer. Are you with me? I'll say, is this what Isa believed? Yes. This is exactly what he believed. You can get him better. The second one is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he made Nabi Allah Ibrahim an imam. Allah made him an imam for every prophet after him. Whereas all the other prophets, Allah didn't mention that for them. He did not make them an imam. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari chose the second reason why it is mentioned, Millata Ibrahim. Ibn Jarir al-Tabari, the great Mufassir, he chooses the second reason why it's always attached to Ibrahim. Ibadah of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in the Sharia has two meanings. First one is ma'na, which is am, a general meaning. Ibadah has two definitions in the Sharia. One is a very comprehensive and a general meaning. And it means, that one means, امتثال خطاب الشرع المقترن, أما مقترن, sorry, بالحب والخضوع. It is امتثال خطاب الشرع المقترن بالحب والخضوع. It is following the Sharia with complete love and complete humiliation. And we brought the line of poetry, وَعِبَادَةُ الرَّحْمَانِ غَايَةُ حُبِّهِ وَخُضُوعِ قَاصِدِهِ هُمَا قُطْبَانِ وَعِبَادَةُ الرَّحْمَانِ غَايَةُ حُبِّهِ وَخُضُوعِ قَاصِدِهِ هُمَا قُطْبَانِ. The backbone or the pillars in which ibadah stands on is what? وَعِبَادَةُ الرَّحْمَانِ غَايَةُ حُبِّهِ, complete love. وَخُضُوعِ, and also humiliating yourself for him. Allah, you pray to him with complete love and complete humiliation simultaneously. I take my face, I put it on the ground, in the dust and in the earth. Whilst I'm doing that, I completely love him. But if somebody else made me do that for them, love has no place in it, in my heart for them. I might do that for them. إِلَّا مَنْ أُكْرِهَ وَقَلْبُهُ مُطْمَئِنُّ بِالْإِمَانِ Because you've forced me to it. You might have humiliated me. But love and humiliation for the same, simultaneously, at the same time. هَذَا لِلَّهِ وَحْدَهِ It's only for Allah. Now some people, they fall in love with a woman which he meets. And he gives her complete love and complete humiliation. And this now becomes serious. It becomes serious. Allah rebuked it in the Quran. وَمِنَ النَّاسِ مَنْ يَتَّخِذُ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ أَنْدَادٍ يُحِبُّونَهُمْ كَحُبِّ اللَّهِ وَالَّذِينَ آمَنُوا أَشَدُّ حُبًّا لِلَّهِ وَلَوْ يَرَى الَّذِينَ ظَلَمُوا إِذْ يَرَوْنَ الْعَذَابَ أَنَّ الْقُوَّةَ لِلَّهِ جَمِيعًا This person has given love to this person like he gave it to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This person, the woman, some man's love has become so much that the woman is able to make him do animal stuff. She'll chain him like a dog and walk him around. He loves her, he'll do it. And the opposite's true. The opposite's true. One brother once said to me, Wallahi, if my wife tells me to cut a part, body part, I will do it for her. Yeah? I worry for a lot of brothers when they get married now. Yeah? Serious. So it's a reality that some people are living. Love is needed. Loving your spouse is what marriage is about. Allah says, وَمِنْ آيَاتِ أَنْ خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مِنْ أَنفُسِهُمْ أَزْوَاجًا لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا وَجَعَلَ بَيْنَكُمْ مَوَدَّةً مَوَدَّةً means love. وَرَحْمَةً and mercy. Compassion and love is something that a marriage is built on. But having complete love and complete humiliation simultaneous at the same time. وَلِذَلِكَ Pay attention. Anything Ibn al-Qayyim says, anybody who loves something completely, you will be punished by that same thing which you loved. That person is going to destroy your life. Because the person's ability is qasir. They can't fulfill your love. You love them so, so much that this person is not coming nowhere close to your love. It's too much. So you're punished in this world. You're in ضيق الصدر. Your heart is tight. Pain, consistent, never finishing. Because you've been texting them 5 times a day. And she's not responding at all. Or she responds once or twice. But you're responding quickly. You're online, WhatsApp, you see, WhatsApp exposes people, subhanAllah, exposes. Is there any way to hide the online? Yeah, there's no way, yeah?
Yeah.
There is, that when you're online, no one can see you.
Oh, no,
online. Last scene, I've done that, I've managed that one, alhamdulillah. Yeah, brother, no one can see you when I'm last on.
There's ways,
though, how to make sure no one can see you online.
You can download the
screen
for WhatsApp.
Oh, okay. Now, save one. Inshallah, we hope we make dua that WhatsApp, whoever's called WhatsApp or whoever's name it is or whoever made it, comes up with the idea of hiding who's online. Sah? It's the worst thing to get caught online. Because a lot of people, it's like they're sitting next to their phones waiting for you to come online. Oh, there you go. I caught you online, sah? Now they added a new feature on it, which is that it's like the Snapchat, right? Where you can put a picture up. And if you do that, people are like, oh, you just put a picture up, brother. You must be online, I saw you. Sah? That also exposes you, subhanAllah. Anyways, the point is, anyone who loves something, they will be punished by it. So no one can really fulfill your love the way Allah can. Sah? Because Allah will surpass your needs. He knows your needs and He knows how to fulfill it. No one else can. وَلِذَلِكَ Allah says in Surah Maryam, وَاتَّخَذُوا مِن دُونِ اللَّهِ آلِهَةً لِيَكُونُوا لَهُمْ عِزَّةً كَلَّا سَيَكْفُرُونَ بِعِبَادَتِهِمْ وَيَكُونُونَ عَلَيْهِمْ ضِدًّا They love their idols. They tried to await, they wanted from their idols and that which they loved. Now everything can be that. You are waiting from it, honor, to be there for you, to be everything you're expecting from it. Allah then says, subhanahu wa ta'ala, that they will be from to them the opposite to what they were waiting from them. So things don't generally come out the way you wanted it to be. Be careful. The second type of ibadah is tawheed. It's tawheed. Many people, instead of the word khudu', they use the word dhul. They say kamalul hubbi ma'a kamalul dhuli. Are you with me, brothers? It's used and it's common and many people use that. But what is wrong for you to use dhul? For two reasons. It's better to use khudu'. But for two reasons, it's what? It's better to use khudu'. The first one is muwafaqatul khitab al-shara. Khudu' is in accordance to the sharia. Are you with me, brothers? The sharia used the word khudu'. That's why the Prophet ﷺ, in the hadith Sahih Bukhari, in the hadith Abi Hurairah, that the Prophet ﷺ, he said, إِنَّ اللَّهَ The Prophet ﷺ said, إِذَا قَضَى اللَّهُ الْأَمْرَ If Allah judges a judgment, فِي السَّمَاءِ إِنَّ السَّمَاوَاتِ When Allah passes a judgment in the sama, ضَرَبَتِ الْمَلَائِكَةُ بِأَجْنِحَتِهَا The angels, they smack their wings. خُضُوعًا لِقَوْلِهِ In humiliation to the statement of Allah and His command. So what was used for the angels? خُضُوع. That's a technical term then. This is the word that the sharia used. So don't use the word dhul. That's the first reason. Second reason is, also even the hadith al-qunut, that Umar radiallahu anhu, in which he used to say, Umar used to say, وَنُؤْمِنُ بِكَ أَوَ اللَّهُ We believe in you. وَنَخْضَعُ لَكَ And we what? We humiliate ourselves for you. بَيْهَقِ نَرَيْتِنِ السُّنَنِ الْكُبْرَى بِسَنِدٍ الصَّحِيحِ The second reason why you should use khudu' and not dhul is because dhul has in it a belief which is that you're being forced, you have no choice. It strips from you any form of any free will. That is qahr and ijbar. Are you with me, brothers? Are you with me, brothers? So that which is that you're forced and that you're forced to do it, it takes the belief of the qadariyatul mujbira, that we're like a leaf on a windy day. That we have no choice. You're coming to the masjid because you're being dragged. You're being dragged. I don't want to pray. I'm being dragged. And because of the fact that you're forced, two harms come out of it automatically. The first one is أَنَّ الْقَلْبَ ذَلِيلٌ فَارِغٌ مِنَ الْإِقْبَالِ بِالتَّعْظِيمِ That the heart is not doing this out of honoring and respecting Allah. It's doing it because I'm weak. I have to do it anyways. It's going to beat me up if I don't. Does that make sense? And another harm that comes out of it, which is what? It brings about, what do you call it, a deficiency in the ibadah itself that you're going to come with. You're going to come with, because even the ibadah that you pray, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves for you to come with it in a nice, beautiful manner, right? When you're praying the salah, Allah loves you subhanahu wa ta'ala to dress yourself. Whereas the tasawwuf and the sufiyyah, the usage of the word dhul, has taken them. So taqa'ur, he just sits and he dresses the most unappealing way. Ripped clothes all day, and he gets closer to Allah with this, and that's not correct. Are you with me, brothers? Inna Allah jamilun yuhibbul jamal. Allah is beautiful and He loves beauty. ولذلك the Prophet said to Ya Rasulullah that a man loves to dress up, and he loves when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam talked about kibr. Kibr is what? Batarul haq wa ghamtun nas. Belittling the people and rejecting the truth. Then the Sahaba says, Ya Rasulullah, amongst us is a person who's what? Who loves to dress with new shoes, he likes to wear new clothes, he likes to dress nicely. The Prophet ﷺ said, Inna Allah jameelun yuhibbu al-jamal. Allah is beautiful and He loves beauty. In another hadith, the Prophet ﷺ said, a totally different hadith, the Prophet said, Inna Allah yuhibbu, Allah loves, an yara athara ni'mati ala abdi. Allah loves to see the blessing of His on His slave. Allah loves it. He gave you money. Allah loves for it to be seen on you. So there's that balance. Are you with me, brothers? But if the person dresses simple and doesn't go simple in the sense where he buys 3-4 set clothes and he irons them, he cleans them, he wears this, and he chooses to live that lifestyle, that's even better. If a person's got a number amount of clothes, as long as it does not reach the level of extravagance. And extravagance is an issue that revolves around the community and the customs of the people you're from. Even the brothers. what will be considered extravagant in one country may not be considered extravagant in another country. Are you with me? So it's an issue that revolves around urf, customs. Does that make sense? Then the author, rahimahullah, he brought qawluhu ta'ala, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. We mentioned this before, the dalala of the ayah is in two different angles. The author is using this ayah, and how is he trying to use this ayah as an evidence? The way he's trying to use it is, first of all, the ayah has two ways of extracting the evidence. One is dalala, which is sarih, a direct angle, it's direct. And that is, Allah created you. That's one thing that the ayah is saying. And that's what's known in Usool al-Fiqh, mantuq al-ayah. The mantuq of the ayah, the apparent meaning of the verse is what? Allah created you. That's the clear command that the ayah is giving you. The second way that ayah, a ruling can be extracted from it is لازم لفظها. The meaning that necessitates from the wording, which is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, since He's the one who created you, and since He's the one who provides for you, and He's the one who brought you into this universe, then He is the one who deserves to. But that's not in a verse that you should worship Him. That's لازم لفظها. You're necessitating from the speech. And we mentioned yesterday, necessitating something from the Qur'an. Can it be a proof? Yes, the Qur'an, yes. Not a human being like Him. You can't necessitate a statement from my words. But from Allah you can, and you can make it a ruling. Because the Qur'an does not contradict itself in its direct meaning and what you are necessitated from it. It doesn't. That's why the Qur'an is mu'jiz, it's a miracle. But me, I may intend the mantuq and not the mafhum. I may intend what I said, but not what you necessitated. Because we're humans, our speech is so weak. And it's so low in its weight. Then the author, rahimahullah, he says, وَبِذَلِكَ أَمَرَ اللَّهُ جَمِيعَ النَّاسِ. And because of that, Allah commanded all of the people. So the word nasi shouldn't be translated as people. Because the word nas, fi أَصَحِّ الْقَوْلَيْنِ عِنْدَ الْعُلَمَاءِ. According to the strongest view of the scholars, the word nas, it encompasses the jinn and the ins. The jinns are known as nas, and the human beings are also known as nas. Are you with me, brothers? They both fall under that same wording. The author here, what of the two is he trying to take the evidence from? Is he taking it from the sarih al-nasiha, or is he taking it from lazim al-lafziha? He's taking it from the second, right? Which is worship Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Since He created, provided for you, that sustains you, worship Him subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the author, rahimahullah, he described ya'budun to what? Ya'budun, he says, wa ma'na ya'budun ay yuwahidun. This definition of him, of his, of ibadah mean tawheed, is something that he was preceded in. But before I mention it being preceded, it has two ways of looking at it. Number one, the first one is the word ibadah, one of its root meanings, ibadah is very comprehensive, and one of its root meanings, or the root meaning of it, is at-tawheed. The second one is the Sharia uses the word ibadah as tawheed. This is the tafsir min al-lafzi bima wudi alahu fi khitab al-shara. We mentioned before, we said the Sharia has a way it uses words. The word ibadah in the Quran, it comes as tawheed. And that's why Ibn Abbas said, kullu ma warada fi al-Quran min al-ibadati fa ma'naha at-tawheed. Every place in the Quran that the word ibadah occurs, it means what? It means a tawheed. And Imam al-Baghawi, you mentioned this in his tafsir. Well, if I ask you all a question right now, what's the first command in the Quran when you open the Mus'haf today and you read Surah Al-Fatiha and then you go to Surah Al-Baqarah? Which ayah is the first command in the Quran? The first command? Baqarah. Where? يا أيها الناس اعبدوا ربكم. That's the first command in the Quran. You open the Mus'haf today, you read Surah Al-Fatiha, you restart Baqarah after that, you read Baqarah, the first ayah that's going to come to you that's commanding you to do something is Ya Ayyuhan Nas U'budu. That shows you how powerful it is for the concept of ibadah to be come with. Ya Ayyuhan Nas, O people. Nasiya means what? Al jinnu wal insu. Fi asahhi qawlayn 'inda al ulama'i. Ya Ayyuhan Nas U'budu. Ma ba'ala U'budu. Ay wahidu. Single him. Based on the view of Ibn Abbas, which he mentioned. Are you with me, brothers? And we mentioned in the sharh of the kitab Al-Qawa'id Al-Arba', we mentioned that the word ibadah and the word tawheed, they come together on some things and they also differ on something. What is it that they come together on? They come together and they differ. They come together in one thing, which is إِذَا نُذِرَ إِلَىٰ إِرَادَةِ التَّقَرُّ. Both of them are intended by getting closer to Allah. Ibadah, you want to get closer to Allah by it, and tawheed is what? Getting closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the intent of the heart for ibadah and the intent of the heart for tawheed are both the same. This is where they come together. This is where the ittifaq happens. As you all know, the author said in Kitab al-Qawa'id al-Arba'a, what did he say? فَاعْلَمْ أَنَّ الْعِبَادَةَ لَا تُسَمَّى عِبَادَةً إِلَّا مَعَ التَّوْحِيدِ. No. And the ibadah, the ibadah is not called an ibadah except with what? With tawheed. And that's what he meant by it. When he said that, he meant this first one. The second is when they are different. And they don't mean the same. And that is when you look at the actions that you're doing. Ahad al-a'mal. Are you with me? Then in this, the ibadah is more comprehensive than tawheed. Because ibadah is what? Is all act of obedience. Tawheed, on the other hand, is more of a specific thing. It's more of a specific thing, which is an action of the heart which you need to come with. So we say, يَتَّفِقَانِ تَارَةً وَيَفْتَرِقَانِ تَارَةً. It comes together sometimes, and it goes against each other sometimes. Then the author, rahimahullah, he said, after that, وَأَعْظَمُ مَا نَهَى عَنْهُ, the greatest thing which Allah commanded. So وَأَعْظَمُ مَا أَمَرَ اللَّهُ بِهِ, the greatest thing Allah commanded is what? At-tawheed, right? What is the greatest thing which Allah commanded? At-tawheed. And then he says وَأَعْظَمُ مَا نَهَى عَنْهُ الشِّرْكُ, and the greatest thing which Allah prohibited is what? Brothers, then pay attention. Shirk is the greatest thing Allah prohibited. Brothers and sisters, pay attention to this. And that is if Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the greatest thing which He commanded is tawheed, you should spend your time learning tawheed. La, ikhwani, it is not present in the religion something greater than tawheed. And shirk is the worst thing. It is the greatest thing Allah prohibited subhanahu wa ta'ala. Spend your time studying in it. It won't benefit you learning nahw and sarf and qira'at and this if you have shirk with you. Not that I'm belittling these sciences. These sciences are important, and that's why we're studying them. We are studying all those other sciences. And yes, we do teach all those sciences. But what we're saying is that the first thing that a person needs to make sure that he studies and he gives time to is at-tawheed. Tawheed. And the greatest thing that a person should know to stay away from is ash-shirk. That's why the author, rahimahullah, he went to both of them. He didn't just give you the definition of a tawheed. Is this book talking about tawheed or shirk? It's talking about tawheed. But because you can't learn something properly if you don't know its opposite. وَيُعْرَفُ بِضِدِّهِ وَبِهِ تَتَمَيَّزُ الْأَشْيَاءِ. If you want to know something, it's always easier. Let's just say you go to China, you met a person, you say to me, listen, I'm looking for a tall person. And so they looked at you and said to you, I don't know. They responded to you by telling you that they didn't understand the word tall, what it means. So you say to them, a short person. He says, I know what short is. You say, it's the opposite of short. It's tall. So opposite allows, if a person knows the opposite, that's why if you go to Arabic institutes today, like Egypt and other countries, and they want to teach you mufradat, terminologies and words, they always give you the opposite to it, huh? They give you the muradif and the muradif of it, which is the and the acts of it, mubayyin, that which is opposite to the wording. It allows you to understand what it means properly. It's settled in. So that's why it's important when you learn tawheed, you learn shirk. So the author, rahimahullah ta'ala, he mentions that they are the two greatest things that a person should either do and come with, which is tawheed, or stay away from, which is a shirk. So what is tawheed? Tawheed has two definitions in the sharia. Number one, it's a general definition. And that is, tawheed has a general definition in the sharia. It means ifradullah bihaqqihi, singling Allah in his rights. What is it to single Allah in his rights? It's to single him in tawheed al-rububiyyah, uluhiyyah, and asma'i wa-sifat. Those are his rights, three of them. Pay attention. Tawheed, which is ta'rifuhu al-'am, its general meaning is ifradullah bihaqqihi, singling Allah in his rights. And Allah's rights are two types. Haqqun fil ma'rifati wal ithbat and haqqun fil iradati wal talab. Or in other words, simple terms, Allah's huquq are three: tawheed al-rububiyyah, uluhiyyah, al-asma'i was-sifat. There's a second definition for tawheed, and it means ifradullah bil ibadah, singling Allah in ibadah, which is only uluhiyyah, not the other two. Muhammad ibn Abdul Wahhab generally means that. And that's the general meaning that it should be for you when you speak about tawheed. Because rububiyyah and uluhiyyah is not the discussion with the pagans and the polytheists and the grave worshippers. That's already a mahalu tifaq. Are you with me, brothers? That's not something you should make the discussion on at hand. Even al-isma'i wa-sifat is a discussion open as well. But the tawheedul uluhiyyah was what the prophets were debating and arguing their nations with. So that's why the definition of a tawheed also means ifradullah bil ibadah, singling Allah tabarak wa ta'ala in ibadah. That's why the author said it here. What did he say? When he defined it, what did he say? At-tawheed wa huwa ifradullah bil ibadah. Muhammad Abdul Wahhab says ifradullah bil ibadah, singling Allah in what? In ibadah. He doesn't mention anything other than that. And the greatest thing which Allah prohibited is what? Shirku. Shirk is the greatest thing which Allah tabarak wa ta'ala prohibited. Shirk in the sharia means two things as well. It's a general meaning. Shirk has two meanings in the sharia. One which is a general meaning, and that is ja'alu shay'in min haqqillahi li ghayri. It is to place and to give. It is to give. Ja'alu shay'in. It's to place and make something from the rights of Allah to other than Allah. That means shirk. That's one. The second meaning is a specific meaning, and that is ja'alu shay'in min al-ibadati li ghayri Allah, making and giving ibadah to other than Allah, specific to ibadah. The first one is, it's just the opposite of the first tawheed. The first tawheed was what? Yeah, giving Allah his rights, right? Singling Allah in his rights, right? The shirk, on the other hand, is what? Associating partners with Allah in his rights. The second one is associating partners with Allah in ibadah specifically. So the first shirk is in shirk of what? Rububiyyah, uluhiyyah, and al-isma'i wa-sifat. The second definition of shirk is a what? Shirkun fil uluhiyyati faqat. Only in uluhiyyah. Does that make sense? If you look at the definition I gave, I said ja'alu shay'in. I used ja'alu. Some people would say sarfu shay'in min haqqillahi li ghayri. That you use the word sarf instead of the word ja'al. Sarf means to divert. Ja'alu is to make. They would use that term instead of that this term. And the reason is because the term ja'al is correct and you should not use the word sarf. Reason is for two reasons. Number one, muwafaqatul khitab al-shar'i. The word ja'al is in accordance to the usage of the sharia. The sharia uses the word ja'al, not the usage of sarf. Because Allah says in the Quran, فَلَا تَجْعَلُوا لِلَّهِ أَنْدَادًا وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ فَلَا تَجْعَلُوا فَلَا تَجْعَلُوا. Don't do. Do not do. لِلَّهِ أَنْدَادًا فَلَا تَجْعَلُوا. That's the word that was used. Also in the hadith which Abdullah ibn Mas'ud narrated, which is in Bukhari and Muslim, أَنْ تَجْعَلَ لِلَّهِ نِدًّا وَهُوَ خَلَقَكَ. أَنْ تَجْعَلَ لِلَّهِ نِدًّا وَهُوَ خَلَقَكَ. The Prophet said, and taj'al is used here. and the word salaf is not used. The second reason is because the word ja'al, what it has in it is your heart taking Allah as your Lord and turning towards Him. Whereas sarf, it means turning away from Him. And in terms of meaning, which was better, turning to Him or turning away from Him? A meaning that has turning is better than a meaning that has turning away. Turning away from, the one that has turning to is better in terms of meaning. Or in simple terms, the word ja'al, it has that you've taken this as your ilah. Are you with me, brothers? That you've taken this as your ilah. And that this is what you see as an ilah when you use the word ja'al. Whereas the word sarf, when you use it, it doesn't mean your heart has taken this. Are you with me? And that's the meaning we want to say that you took this thing as your Lord. Then the author, rahimahullah, he mentions qawluhu ta'ala, the statement of Allah, وَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا. Worship Allah and do not associate partners with Him. وَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ, worship who? Allah, وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا. This ayah is in Surah An-Nisa. It's in Surah An-Nisa. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions it. What is the dalalah? Well, how is the author trying to take evidence from this one? He's taking from evidence from it from two angles. The first one is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He started the ayah with what? This ayah, by the way, is ayat that talk about huquq and responsibilities that are upon you. Responsibilities that you have to come with. Which is the first responsibility that Allah started with? Ibtada'a ibadatu wahda, worshipping alone. So He's trying to use that. And we took already, what does the word ibadah in the Quran when it comes, what does it mean? Already we took tawheed, so it's tawheed. And then what does it prohibit you from straight away? Wa'abudullah wa la tushriku bihi shay'an. And don't associate partners with Allah. So that's why he's using it. That's the first one. His first evidence is al-ibtida. Look, Allah started with it. And then look at all the rights that are mentioned after that. This is the first one. The second thing that he's trying to take from the ayah is atfu ma ba'dahuma alayhima. That every single thing has been connected to this. The ayah starts with what? وَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ, worship Allah, وَلَا تُشْرِكُوا بِهِ شَيْئًا, don't associate partners with Him. وَبِالْوَالِدَيْنِ, the wow is connected to وَعْبُدُ اللَّهَ. Be obedient towards your parents. And do not be dutiful towards your parents. وَبِذِي الْقُرْبَى, and also be dutiful towards your family members. وَالْيَتَامَى, and the orphans. All of those are atf, they are connected to ibadah. Because it's important, more important than them. Now.
فإذا قيل لك ما الأصول الثلاثة التي يجب على الإنسان معرفتها تقول معرفة العبد ربه ودينه ونبيه محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم.
The author here, رحمه الله, the author, رحمه الله, he clarifies that all of the people are created to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and they are commanded to do that. And then he also mentioned that it's upon every single body, every single one of us, to know three foundations, three principles, three fundamental principles. And these are the three fundamental principles in which his book is written for. He wrote his book for this. It's knowing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It is knowing the religion. And it is also knowing the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Because you're not able to come with ibadah. You will not be able to come with ibadah unless you know these three. Why? You need to know, number one, you need to know ma'rifatul ma'budu alladhi tuj'alu lahu al-ibadah. Who is the one I have to worship to do this ibadah for? Who is it that I'm doing this ibadah for? You have to know him. And who is it that we're doing it for? Allah. So you have to know who Allah is. Second one is ma'rifatul muballigh 'anil ma'budi. Who is the one who is conveying you this ibadah which you have to come with? Who is he? And that is who? The Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. And the third one, which is ma'rifatu kayfiyat al-ibadah. How should I do this ibadah? Which is the what? Wahiya deen, it's the religion. So all of these three, the reason why the author wants you to come, he wants you to know all three of these, is because ibadah cannot be done without these three. Who will you pray to? Who commanded you? Who is it that commanded you to pray like this? How is it that you have to pray and worship him? All three of those questions are a branch that stems from knowing Allah, knowing the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam, and knowing the religion of Islam. These are the three questions that a person will be asked in their grave. It is the three questions that you're going to be asked in your grave. And every single Muslim should know that when you're asked, what are these three questions, that you have an answer ready for it. Okay, inshallah ta'ala, we're going to conclude there bi'idhnillahi al-kareem. Subhanakallahumma bihamdik. Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah. Astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayhi.